Hello. I would like to talk today about self-virtualizing Ethernet devices and how to make these devices more secure. This is joint work with Muli, Ben-Yehuda and Professor Tsafrir, and the research was conducted in Technion, Israel Institute of Technology. So, in a nutshell, generally virtualization solutions are complex, and many different technologies are mixed together. I will talk about two of such technologies, SRIOV and Ethernet flow control. I will explain later in details about each of these technologies. So mixing technologies sometimes gives fine results. For example, Coke and Mentos, but in security it's not funny. So each of these technologies individually secure, but when we putting in, them together, we have a security problem. I will show a new attack where untrusted virtual machine can completely control the network bandwidth and latency of other virtual machines that are using same SRIOV device. And then I will show how and explain how to build an attack-resistant SRIOV Ethernet device. So what are the consequences of this attack? How can we defend against this attack? The simple thing, we can just trust our virtual machines. Such solution would not be acceptable for cloud providers, private or public cloud. Another option is to give up on flow control functionality. And in this case, we will lose performance. This would not be acceptable for data centers and high-performance computing setups. Or we can modify device hardware or firmware and change it such a way that it will protect us from the attack. We have tested SRIOV Ethernet devices of all major manufacturers, and we found that all of them are vulnerable. So we have two technologies, SRIOV, Ethernet flow control, where I promise you to show the attack and the solution. But first, I would like to talk about background, how SRIOV works and how Ethernet flow control integrates in all this picture. So we can virtualize I/O in software. We have emulation, also known as trap and emulate, and we can use paravirtualization. In both cases, we let hypervisor or host to control each I/O transaction. For example, in context of networking, hypervisor will perform multiplexing, switching, and firewalling. And for that, we pay price of performance. To improve virtualization I/O performance, we can remove hypervisor from the I/O pass and let virtual machine access I/O device directly without hypervisor involvement. So, seems nice, direct device assignment, give great performance, very low latency, but there is a limitation. It is not scalable. Most modern servers have 5, maybe 10 I/O devices that can be installed, but these servers can run up to hundreds of virtual machines, so we do not have enough I/O devices to assign to each virtual machine. So what can we do? To overcome this limitation, single root IO virtualization specification called SRIOV was invented. SRIOV describes PCI Express self-virtualizing devices. Each device, this is a PCI Express devices. Each device presents itself as many virtual interfaces. And specification SRIOV supports up to 64,000 interfaces. It's in theory. In practice, it's limited by the implementation. For example, Intel 40 gigabit interface, SRIOV capable, implements 128 virtual interfaces. Mellanox Connectix 3 implements 256 virtual interfaces. A little bit more details of SRIOV. So we have we have a PCI Express device. Each PCI Express device has a physical function called PF. And many virtual functions called VF. PF completely controls the device and all virtual functions. It controls control plane and data plane as well. Physical function generally accessible only by hypervisor. Virtual machine have no access to the physical function. Virtual functions is a kind of lightweight PCI Express function, mostly performs I/O and accessible by virtual machines. So where do we use SRIOV? Why it is so important? With SRIOV, it is possible now to virtualize high-performance computing setups. Cloud service providers use SRIOV as the underlying technology, for example, Amazon EC2. Data centers use SRIOV as, for example, Oracle Exalogic appliance use SRIOV as backbone internal network on their appliances. So we have some understanding of SRIOV. Now I will talk about Ethernet flow control. Traditional Ethernet is lossy. There is no guarantee that transmitted Ethernet frame will be delivered to its destination. Vast majority of drops happen when receiver's buffers are full and the receiver has no available memory to store incoming data frames. So to make Ethernet lossless and reliable, Ethernet flow control protocol was proposed. There is an extended version of flow control, priority flow control, which use the same mechanism. And in this talk, I will, for the sake of simplicity, will refer to flow control to both of them. So how does it work? It is important to mention that Ethernet flow control works between two Ethernet devices. For example, Ethernet switch and network interface connected to the switch with cable. Now let's take a look how Ethernet flow control mechanism works between switch and a network interface specifically. First, the sender, the Ethernet switch, transmits data faster than receiver network interface can process. So receiver runs out of space. So what can receiver do? Drop packets or use flow control. In this case, receiver need more time to process its buffer, so it sends to the switch MAC control frame with a pause request. Such MAC control frame this is a special type of Ethernet frame that we called pause frame, and it used explicitly for communications between Ethernet devices. As soon as the switch receives the pause frame, it receives pause request. It stops transmitting the data for requested period of time, and giving the receiver opportunity to process its buffer and free more space to receive data. So let's assume that receiver completely runs out of buffers, and now receiver wants to tell sender to completely stop transmissions. So how fast receiver should send pause frame request in order to ask sender to stop transmissions completely? The answer depends on the link speed. For example, if we take a look on the table, the second row describes the 10 gigabit link. So single pause frame on 10 gigabit link will stop transmission for 3.36 milliseconds. So it is easy to calculate to completely stop the transmissions. 299 pause frames per second required. So how can we attack with flow control? Following observations. First of all, flow control works on link level, physical connection between switch and the network interface. Link is shared between virtual machines. All virtual machines with direct access to the virtual function of the same physical function share the same physical link to the switch. So each flow control pause frame halts traffic on the entire link. As a result, all virtual functions associated with this physical function are affected. So let's take a look at how can we run the attack. As I mentioned in the previous slide, for 10 gigabit link, which is capable to transmit more than 10 million frames per second, only almost 300 frames per second required to stop completely the transmission. So if I want to reduce traffic to 5 gigabit, I need to send 150 frames per second. So comparing to the millions of frames that are running on, the wire, 150 frames per second, very hard to discover. So it's like a ninja, almost does not leave traces. So malicious virtual machine sends a pause frame. What happens? All traffic on the shared link pauses. Then timer expires and traffic resumes until the malicious virtual machine sends the next pause frame again. How did we evaluate the attack? The setup was straightforward and simple. Two servers connected to the Ethernet switch, 10 gigabit. One server act as a client, a second server as a host. A host configured with SRIOV device with two virtual functions. There are two virtual machines connected, one physical function, one virtual function connected to one virtual machine. VM1 has the virtual function 1, VM2 has the virtual function 2. Traffic generated between client and virtual machine 1 and virtual machine 2 is the attacker that sends pause frames to the switch. As soon as the VM2 sends pause frame, switch halts its transmissions, and traffic between client and VM1 is affected. So let's take a look at the results. We measured victim's throughput, its axis Y, throughput and the latency, and X is the pause frame that attacker sends each second. So the graph is actually the function of the throughput or latency as a function of pause frames that attacker sends. Graph on the right shows the victim latency, and graph on the left shows the victim's throughput. We can clearly see that attacker can completely control the throughput and the latency with great precision. So what do we propose? How can we defend ourselves? First, we would like to, in theory, speak about the ideal solution. So in ideal, we would like to filter outbound traffic transmitted by a virtual function. But let's return to the beginning of my talk. When we assigned virtual function directly to the virtual machine, we actually removed hypervisor from the IO pass. And what we did, we offloaded some of the hypervisor's functionality, such as multiplexing and switching, to the NIC's hardware. This is why we have a performance boost. But this is not enough. We also need to offload some filtering capabilities to the network interface. In case we had a problem with a hypervisor that needs additional filtering, it's easy to configure another rule in the hypervisor. But with hardware, it's not easy. We need to replace hardware or replace firmware. Namely, we want network interface to filter all outbound malicious pause frames from virtual functions. How do we identify malicious frames? First of all, we need to identify valid pause frames. So valid pause frames are generated by physical function and have physical function MAC address in their source. So malicious pause frames are sent with source address of virtual functions. So as I mentioned, in ideal world, SRIOV NIC hardware, we would modify network interface, its hardware or firmware, and that's it. We have a solution. But hardware and and firmware are proprietary closed source. So we need to find some approximation or prototyping. Actually, all currently available SRIOV NICs are proprietary, and we cannot change the hardware or firmware. So we built virtualization-aware network flow control. We built virtualization-aware network flow controller, in short, VANFC. And the VANFC is a software-based prototype of SRIOV Ethernet device with pause frame filtering capability. The VNFC design. As I already mentioned, VNFC is a software-based prototype. It's approximation of a real hardware solution. But the idea of the solution actually is being used now by some vendors. I will talk about later. SRIOV Ethernet device has an internal switch with a very basic Ethernet switch capability. So what we want to do is to add software-based extension to this NIC internal switch. This switch extension, based on Linux bridge, and simply filters out all malicious pause frames sent from virtual function. On the VNFC schema, we can see the Linux-based bridge box that does all the filtering in software. So it's completely transparent, so switch and network interface are not aware of the existence of this box. So how VNFC performs? We tested multiple workloads in a 10 gigabit Ethernet setup. On the left is throughput oriented. On the right, it's latency oriented. First, let's compare performance of standard SRIOV device, red bars, or baseline system, with VNFC, blue bars. This is a protected system, not under attack. So from the graph, we see that VNFC introduced no performance degradation without the attack. Second, let's take a look how VANFC performs under the attack. In this scenario, we send 150 pulse frames per second. Just to remind you, we are using 10 gigabit Ethernet NIC link. So it should reduce performance to 50%. OK, underlying standard SRIOV device, green bars. OK, as we see, we tested SRIOV and the SRIOV device under attack. It's the green bars. And it shows that 50% performance degradation as expected. Now we tested VANFC under the attack, yellow bars, and it shows no performance degradation and successfully blocks the attack. What is the situation, current situation in the industry? We notified all major vendors that manufacture an SRIOV Ethernet devices. For example, Mellanox sent us updated custom version for of firmware for ConnectX 3 device for testing, and the official release will be in somewhere in late August. Their new ConnectX 4 is in progress. They are going to fix it as well. QLogic that use Broadcom chips, chipsets. Recently sent us a new driver with updated firmware for testing. Their fix is actually based on the proposed solution of filtering malicious pulse frames sent from virtual functions. We share the result and our findings with them. And the public release expected soon. All other vendors, all other major vendors, were notified as well. But no solution currently available. They are working on it. So let's go to conclusions. When we offload software function, software functionality to hardware, we gain performance. But we lose flexibility of software, and we may face interoperability problems. This is what happened with SRIOV and flow control. In our work, we show that removing host from the IO pass requires adding filtering functionality to the hardware because we found that current implementation of Ethernet SRIOV devices is not compatible with Ethernet flow control. We show the new attack that exploits the vulnerability in SRIOV Ethernet devices. Our solution, the VANFC, prevents the attack and introduces no performance degradation. And future works include extending our findings to SRIOV InfiniBand devices, fiber channel, NVMe SSDs, and GPGUs. Thank you. Questions?
Plenty of time for questions. Please step up to the mic.
Yuxiong Sun from Penn State. So I have a question regarding the attack. So if I understand correctly, between two pulse frames, neither the attacker VM or the victim VM can receive any frames from the edge switch, right?
That's correct. It's kind of denial of service.
Okay, so is there a way that you can actually steal the bandwidth, like you deny the victim VM's connection, but you allow the attacker's VM's connection?
No, it blocks completely the link.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, this is Jisung from KAIST. Thank you for the presentation. I have a question. So what if the attacker can spoof the VM's source MAC address as the physical network address?
All SRIOV Ethernet devices already have anti-spoofing functionality. So the same internal Ethernet switch that I mentioned in one of the slides already has filtering capabilities, but it filters only on source MAC address. So you do not spoof other virtual machines. Except that we propose to extend this functionality. This is what we proposed in our solution. But you cannot spoof.
Okay, thank you.
I got one question.
Mic
that one. So my question, what happens when you have a vendor who issues, let's say, a fix? How does that, is it compatible with VANFC at the same time? What would happen if?
Can you repeat, please?
So you mentioned some of the vendors have issued a firmware fix.
Yeah.
Is that incompatible or still compatible if you're running your VANFC fix at the same time?
Actually, we received the fixes just right before the conference, so we didn't have a chance to test it. But generally, I believe people. So if they say that we fix it, you can verify it. I believe they fix. But I don't know how Mellanox fixed it. They do not open the information, but QLogic explicitly say that they use our techniques to filter the malicious power frames, and they found it working.
Great. Well, let's thank our speaker one more time.